And we're going to ask you to bow your head just for a moment. Father, we thank you for your grace, your goodness, and all that you have done. We thank you for leading and directing all that we will say, all that we will do in the Spirit, things that you will bring to our hearts as we speak. Father, we thank you in Jesus' name. We give you praise and the glory for the work that you have begun, the work that you have begun. You will continue to perform it. Father, we thank you today that you are at work now, working in us your will and the doing of your good pleasure. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Okay, I have six keys to stay in focus. And you're going to really see that this is going to be very vital, a very vital time in your Christian walk. So you really want to stay focused, and I'm giving you six principles that will enable you to stay focused. The scripture I'm going to speak from, it's going to be Hebrews 6, 12. I'm going to use the story of Daniel to illustrate the points that I'm making. I want you to turn to Hebrews 6 and 12. It says that he be not slothful. Well, let's look at verse 11 and verse 10. For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which ye have showed toward his name, in that ye have ministered to the saints and do minister. And we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end. That ye be not slothful, some call it slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. That ye be not slothful or slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promise. Okay, there's another scripture, Colossians 1:21. Through 23, I want you to look at that scripture, Colossians 1:21 through 23. And you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. If ye, watch this, if ye continue in the faith, grounded and settled. So this is what we're talking about today. Staying grounded, staying settled. And be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which ye have heard and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister. Okay, so you want to grasp those particular scriptures, which tells us that we need to keep our focus, stay grounded, stay rooted. And the very first things that you learn in your Christian walk, those are the things that you want to get back to if you have departed or moved away or shifted away from them. So I'm going to give you some good reasons in a minute. I want to give you one more scripture, Hebrews 2. Hebrews 2, verses 1 through 4. All of these are dealing with stay rooted, stay grounded, stay rooted. Don't be tossed to and fro. It's a whole lot of things are happening today in the body of Christ. And I'm going to apprise you of some of these things that's happening, and you're going to be Paul. Therefore, this is Hebrews 2, verses 1 through 4. Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him. God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders and with divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost, according to your own will. Okay, so this shows that the word that we have heard is steadfast, is unremovable, and God has already confirmed it through those that he spoke through. So this is the true, the real word of God. And you don't want to get away from that which can carry you to where Jesus has already prepared for you to go. Amen. I want to share with you some things that is going on in the body of Christ, is that there is a movement going on, and we can see a whole lot of this on television. You can feel the spirit of Antichrist in everything that relates to Christianity almost. It's just really difficult to stay motivated and to stay encouraged, because you can see all of the corruption and all of the sin and ungodliness, even in the name of the church, in the name of the Lord. So it's very frustrating for you to distinguish between the real and the unreal. There was a bestseller book years ago that most of us read, and it was a good book. It was called The Purpose-Driven Life, and the most recent by the author that all of us know. The most recent was The Purpose-Driven Church, but I just wanted to share some of the things that is motivating that movement, and this is not just that movement, but a whole lot of the major movements today are being motivated by certain things. This was written by Dr. Noah Hutchins, and he said that there's a movement in which pastors from traditional churches are changing their approach to modern day approaches to make the unchurched to feel more comfortable. To make the, there's a move, you know, we're trying to appeal more to the unchurched, and so many times it means compromising a whole lot of things that we have stood for in the past to come down to a level where we can be received or accepted by the unchurched. And he says that this movement is becoming notorious for splitting churches and removing those who don't approve of the new direction the movement is headed. Pastors are changing, these are some of the things that's actually taking place. Pastors are changing the decor that is inside of the church to that of a nightclub or bars, so that these unchurched may feel a lot more comfortable, and it will seem more like a home environment rather than a church environment. This is what they're doing. All right, now this is why the pulpits, the crosses, and other emblems, or anything that identify with the Bible or God, must be removed. Now these are churches that are gradually denying the cross, denying the blood, and they're really going liberal in an effort to reach the masses. They're reaching the masses. So there's nothing to see a church now 20,000 or 25,000. Now, since not many of the elderly go to the nightclubs, beer joints, or casinos, therefore, it is best to get rid of those old pillars who only hold things up. They make the unchurched uncomfortable. And that, this is really true, that a lot of the old pillars, people that have traditional values, people that really believe the Bible, many times they are being rooted out of the churches with a lot of the new concepts that they are trying to institute to draw large numbers of people. Now, there are 12 things that I just wrote down, it was 24, to show the dark side of this movement. There are 12 things that I just wrote, I didn't write the half of them, but number one, their mode of operation is to change the music to a contemporary rock style. Now, that's one reason why I don't want to get too far into this modern worship, you know, rock style, and forget about all the hymns, throw all the old songs out, and you just go on with these songs that don't say nothing.
That's right.
So, out of that song, you know, scripture saying you don't hear it no more.
Amen.
So you can see the trend. This is not in just certain churches, but most of the churches are going to be foolish to what? Follow this pattern just to hold on to their what? Crown. So you have to determine whether you want to appeal to the crowds and lower your standards and all of the basic principles of the Bible, reject that, or be, you know, a church that, you know, it's going to be hard for a small church. And small churches are really having a challenge. If you can't draw a whole lot of people, you can't institute a whole lot of programs, and therefore, you're just going to stay at a certain level. You can't have paid employees and things like that. But we're going to make the devil a liar on that. And I think you can do it right the right way. And preach the truth. How many believe that? And still be successful and get people interested in what you're doing. How many can say amen? Now, change the music to a contemporary rock style. Number two, remove all hymn books and eliminate the choir as well. Now, this is something that we are seeing more and more of. You very seldom in certain denominations, you'll see choirs anymore. That's old-fashioned, old-time, hymns, singing hymns, and anthems, and what else, word music. You want to keep it with rock because that sounds more like what? Contemporary music. And that's something that the unchurched won't feel what? Threatened by. Now, this is what's going on. That's the reason why we just can't sit here and be lax and indifferent and miss all of these sessions that we're having here, especially prayer sessions, Bible study sessions, and you feel like you're not going to be affected by the spirit of what's around you. Every time you turn on TV, you're going to be what? Threatened to receive a whole lot of these contemporary ideas, even on the religious channels, because they have to do that in order to appeal. See, they're trying to raise millions and millions of dollars, and they don't have to what? Bring whatever they said down to a level where people will receive what they got to what? Bring. All right. Number three, replace the organ and piano with heavy metal instruments for rock. And you'd be surprised. Dress down all casual attire. You see that? No. You know, sometimes, I don't know which way to go. You know, sometimes you say, do we just let everybody just be casual and loose, just do what they want to do, or just let them, or just still hold, have some kind of standards or some kind of requirements for people that's participating in ministry. You know, so you know, these are things that you're really having challenges with now because you know, if people don't like your man of attire, all you have to do is what? Go across town. And join what? The big churches where you can what? Do what you want to do and hide behind the crowd. So these are challenges. Sometimes when you let people, if you give them an inch, they'll take a what? Mile. And a lot of times when you lower the standards in one area, it's going to what? Automatically lower it in what? In another area. So you have to really watch what you hook up with, and you have to pray about stuff and hear from God, otherwise you can be what? Swayed and influenced by everything.